all my fans out there, you're watching My Russian Travels with yours truly, Napoleon Bonaparte.
Tassin! Wine! I don't cook your dinner! Stupid woman. I knew I should have soundproofed the trailer before I moved to this neighborhood. Mama cooked your favorite Kentucky fried chicken wings. Quiet, woman. Some of us are trying to watch Napoleon's new travel program. Sorry, Mr. Tchaikovsky. The donkeys are real hungry this evening. Woohoo! Yeah, man. All this banging, all this clanging. Every day I have to endure.
Blow it up! Blow it up!
Get away from my trailer! Take your guns, take your cannons, and beat it, kidlings! Every night I'm tormented by the noise. Get to my head!
Shut up, Mr. Chai.
Yeah, get lost, Chai, and get back to that music of yours. Hear that, Chai? That's better music than you'll ever make.
We will be taking cannons. Cannons through the countryside to...
Hear that, Chai? That's better music than you'll ever make.
Better music than you'll ever make.
Better music than you'll ever make.
Better music than I'll ever make, huh? Pyotr Tchaikovsky is born in Russia in 1840. When he turns 22, he quits his boring civil service job and enters St. Petersburg's Music Conservatory. It's a new school established by pianist Anton Rubinstein. But life as a composer's not all it's hyped up to be, cause Tchaikovsky's a music scene misfit. Yes, he is. Every other Russian composer's into nationalism, music that's earthy, folky, and, well, just more Russian. Tchaikovsky, on the other hand, he's ploughing his own furrow. It's why international audiences love him, but Russian critics hate him. They say he's over-reliant on Western melodies and harmonies. In fact, there's a big debate raging in 19th century Russia about whether the nation should be accepting Western cultural values at all. A turning point is a speech in 1880 by the great novelist Dostoevsky, who calls for a universal unity with the West. The message spreads throughout Russia, and so too do the Russians start reassessing Tchaikovsky. Within weeks, Anton Rubinstein's brother Nikolai, a great friend of Tchaikovsky, commissions him to write a patriotic concert overture. It's to be played at the Moscow Arts and Industry Exhibition to commemorate the Silver Jubilee of Tsar Alexander II. Pretty convenient too, because it's also to coincide with the consecration of the Cathedral of Christ the Saviour. It's bleeding enormous, taken decades to build, and is almost finished. It's a pretty impressive monument to Russia's victory over Napoleon in 1812. As for Tchaikovsky, he hates what he's been asked to do. There's nothing worse than composing for the sake of some festivities. What's one to write on such an occasion but predictable, noisy music? It's music for the purpose of glorifying something that gives me no delight at all. Neither in the Jubilee of the Tsar, nor in the cathedral, which I don't like at all, is there anything that could stir my inspiration. But one simply doesn't turn down such a prestigious and lucrative offer. So despite his loathing, Tchaikovsky accepts and completes the overture in a single week. It begins with a soulful Russian Orthodox hymn, O Lord, Save Thy People. Just four cellos and violas play a simple, plaintive melody. As ordinary Russian folk gather throughout the nation's churches, they pray for divine intervention. Why? Cause the French army's on the march. Napoleon's got this crazy idea to invade Russia and expand his empire. Well, maybe not that crazy, cause it is an army of 500,000 men and hundreds of state-of-the-art cannons. The Russians' plea for deliverance becomes increasingly heartfelt as the orchestra swells, and out of this wistful hymn emerges some tense passages in the strings. The Russians know their army is only a fraction of the size of the seemingly invincible French. Trouble is brewing on the horizon. Snare drums strike up and we hear the battle theme, aka bada 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 bum bum bum. It's a strong four-time marching beat. we hear distant strains of the French national anthem, the Marseillaise. It becomes more and more prominent as the French near Moscow. Scene change. Let's take a look at what's happening in Russia's quaint countryside villages. A lyrical melody from Tchaikovsky's first opera, The Voivode, sings as the Tsar appeals to his subjects to step up and defend the motherland. A bouncing dance full of energy answers back like some national awakening. It's in fact a traditional Russian folk song called At the Gate. The restless strings in the orchestra represent the anxious villagers scurrying to their places in response to the Tsar's impassioned plea. Scene change, back to the French. The Marseillaise is more aggressive this time, beating down all those pretty pastoral Russian melodies. And let's just pretend we didn't know that Napoleon in fact banned the Marseillaise. Yep, damn right. He replaced it with a lesser-known anthem, and the Marseillaise only returned as the French national anthem in 1879, just 1 year before Tchaikovsky wrote the overture. But we can live with this little historical inaccuracy, cause, well, it's an instantly recognisable tune. Scene change, back to the Russians. There's a return of that pastoral refrain, but this time we get a tussle between both Russian and French melodies. They argue in counterpoint, one warlike, the other relatively peaceful. This is the Battle of Borodino, the bloodiest conflict of the entire Napoleonic Wars. The Marseillaise is more prominent than ever, appearing alone in the horns as the French overwhelm the Russians. Five cannon blasts fire to remind us that until the Battle of Borodino, artillery battalions had rarely been used on such a grand scale. Each cannon is timed offbeat to create the illusion of real atmospheric sound, that we're actually on a battlefield. The strings play a frantic run of descending notes as the Russians retreat back to Moscow with the French in hot pursuit. When the French eventually reach Moscow, Napoleon just walks through the front door without a fight. But it's a trap. The Russians never intended to surrender. In fact, they've already abandoned the city, setting it alight and depleting the winter stores. They've left Moscow barren and desolate. You hear those bells? Ding-a-ling-a-ding-dong? Yep, that's the fire alarm. Or they symbolise the voice of God, who brings an unprecedented winter freeze on the exhausted and weakened French. Famine, disease, and the bitter chill overwhelms them, and with their supply lines overextended, the French are forced to retreat. And now for a return of our favourite theme, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-bam-bam-bam! It's the Russians returning to capture the French cannons stuck in the freezing ground. They turn them back on the frogs, and 11 cannon shots thunder out. A brass band plays God Save the Tsar, the Russian national anthem in Tchaikovsky's time. Napoleon suffered a disastrous defeat, and the Russians are victorious. Now in 1881, the year the overture was to premiere, things didn't go quite according to plan. Tsar Alexander II was assassinated, and the arts and industry exhibition was postponed. Progress on that humongous cathedral slowed too. The original idea was to perform the piece in front of the completed cathedral with the bells chiming on cue to the music. Cannons would be fired from an electric switch panel, synchronising precisely with the score. The brass band was to march on stage at the climactic finale. But guess what? None of that happened. People were too sad about the Tsar's death to party. So the overture premiered in 1882 in a tent near the still unfinished cathedral. No brass band, no cathedral bells, and certainly no cannons. No one knew how difficult it'd be to coordinate the cannon fire with the music. Don't forget, you gun-toting cowboys, there's a time lag between releasing the barrel and the shot sounding. The 1812 overture cemented Tchaikovsky's status as a Russian hero. In his music was reflected the three pillars of the nation, the Russian national anthem for the Tsar, a Russian hymn for the Orthodox Church, and the Russian folk song for the spirit of the Russian people. In comparison, the piece damned the French, reducing them to a single monotonous theme, the Marseillaise, persistent, repetitious, and aggressive. The piece also cemented Tchaikovsky's status as an international superstar. For anyone listening across the world, it presented a clear picture of key historical events, what we now call program music. The only person who hated it was Tchaikovsky.
Very loud and noisy and completely without artistic merit, because I wrote it without warmth and without love. The bombastic cannons, the chiming bells and the brass fanfare all spoke to an audience more interested in theatrics rather than deep personal expression.
He'd be horrified to see the monster his overture's been turned into, appearing in everything from Woody Allen's comedy Bananas to The Muppet Show and The Simpsons. It's become the ultimate showpiece of the pop classics repertoire. Most will recognize it from shamelessly overblown renditions with fireworks on US Independence Day. Tchaikovsky's overture remains a lesson to us all that great music is universal, no matter the story behind it, and that sometimes it's best to leave it to the people to make the final judgment. Well, that's it. Thanks for watching. Follow our channel, leave your feedback, and most importantly, enjoy classical music.